give you all my worship. I will give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise. Thank you.
morning. No, good morning.
Good morning.
There we go. Let's pray. Sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but my ears you have opened. Burnt offerings and sin offerings you did not require. Then I said, here am I have come. I desire to do your will, my God. Your law is within my heart. Lord God, as we have just sung songs that speak of today's text as the foundation for today's text, we have sung amazing words of humility, of desire to follow, to serve, to obey, to because of your great love, because of your faithfulness, because of your mercy. And they're powerful songs. They're the songs that draw us in. But as the psalmist said in Psalm 40, you love to hear us sing. You want us to do that. But if that's the end, then that doesn't mean anything. What you yearn for, what you want, what you credit us for, is that our hearts would be free. That we would give ourselves wholly and completely to you. For life, for love, for the sake of this world, because this is who we were created to be. So as we come to, again, what can seem like a disconnected text in many ways to our situation, to us, help us to, again, get a sense of the awesomeness of who you are. The awesomeness of the fact that you are not just a God of my whims, that you are not just a God who worked 2,000 years ago, that you are not just a God that we can pay lip service to, but that you are a God for before whom we should tremble in awe. Because before creation, you had us in mind. And you have been working on this long-term plan to bring us all together in Christ. So as we read your word very simply, and then as we come to remember again your sacrifice for us, Lord God, may our hearts be able to receive that which your Spirit is saying to us. That the words we have sung may be a reality in the very core of our being. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. So, we are going to pick up where we left last week, which is, well, actually, we're going to start reading our text, and then I'm going to read it through to where we left last week, and then I'm going to comment on it, the rest of the passage, and then come to communion this morning. Just one second here. We are looking at Romans 14 through to Romans 15, verse 13. And it is, in sense, depending on how you look at the book, in some ways the ultimate conclusion. Because anything about God, anything about the teaching, comes down to the fact of our day-to-day lives, how we relate to each other. And Paul has been arguing about the faithfulness of God and what he's done, and he is trying to indicate and to show his readers, what does that mean? What does God call us to? What are the implications of God's faithfulness in the good news of Jesus Christ? So we're just going to read through again very simply the text, bring it up to where we were at drop stop last week, and then I'm going to walk us through a bit more than that. So let's read it together. Not read it together. Don't read it together. Just listen to me as I read it. How's that? That's better. And I just realized I want my computer here. Sorry. So I can read it from here. Paul starts off, receive with open arms. And by the way, pay attention to that one phrase, because he finishes off our section with that same instruction. Receive with open arms the one who is weak in faith, not in order to pass judgment. Indeed, one believes in eating everything. The one, though, who is weak, eats vegetables. Don't let the one eating despise the one not eating. And the one not eating, let that one not judge the one who eats. For God has received the person. Who are you judging another household servant? To that person's own Lord, he or she stands or falls, but he will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make him stand. One day, one esteems a day above another day, but another esteems every day. Let each be convinced in their own minds. The one regarding the day regards it to the Lord, and the one who eats to the Lord, for he gives thanks to God. And the one not eating eats not to the Lord and gives thanks to God. For no one of us lives to ourselves, and no one of us dies to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, or if we die to the Lord. Whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived, that he might be the Lord of all, both the living and the dead. So, you, why are you judging your sibling? Or indeed you, why are you despising your sibling? For we all will stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow to me, and every tongue will confess to God. So, each one of us will give an account of ourselves to God. Therefore, let us stop deciding for one another. Instead, let us decide this. I will not put a stumbling block or a trap in the way of my sibling. I know, and I have been persuaded in the Lord, that nothing is unclean in itself, except the one who considers it unclean. To that one, it is unclean. For if because of food your sibling is grieved, you are no longer walking in love. Do not, by your food, ruin that person for whom Christ died. Therefore, do not let your food be spoken of as blasphemy. For God's reign, God's kingdom is not eating and drinking, but is righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. And the one who serves Christ in this way pleases God and is approved by people. So then, let us pursue the things of peace and the things that build up one another. Don't, for the sake of food, destroy the work of God. All things are indeed clean, but to the evil, to the person causing stumbling by eating. And it is good not to eat flesh, not to drink wine, nor anything else which causes your sibling to stumble. This is where we ended off, and I want to make one comment. We have to continue on here. Second. Yes. I'll finish this page, then I'll make a comment. You who are having faith, have it by yourself before God. In other words, you who have that faith to explore, to do different things that others may not, have it by yourself before God. Blessed is the one who does not judge oneself for what he or she approves. But the one who doubts, if he or she eats, has been condemned because it is not from faith. And all of which is not from faith is sin. By the way, as I was trying to think of how I'm trying to give you a picture of what we're doing here, imagine we're, because I'm living in the country here, and we've got a rancher, at least one rancher here, the cattle have been out in pasture, and I'm kind of, in reading through the text, I'm gathering the cattle together, and then next week I'm going to have them in the corral, and I'll bring it all together for you. Okay? That's the idea. So, I'm commentating along the way, and then we will bring it together next week in a more formal way, hopefully. But Paul is, again, remember that this Paul is working with different understandings of what it means to be a follower of Christ in his time and in the Church of Rome. And the clear differences in that he's writing to, the people he's writing to, the main ones are the difference between Jew and Gentile. But as I said last week, it's complicated by that, because there were Gentiles who became God-fearers who were very sympathetic, and they were wanting to embrace some of the Judaism and the Jewish traditions. And there were Jews who had come to understand their freedom in Christ and didn't see it necessary anymore to follow their Jewish traditions. And so there was quite a few different groups. And of course, their traditions were strongly held. I mean, imagine yourself, most of us are transplants from somewhere, from some other tradition. And just imagine what it's like when you've come into a different tradition and, well, they do that. That drives me nuts. Worship is a key one, right? Hymn versus courses. Infant baptism versus immersion, baptism by immersion. Fred brought out wine versus grape juice. I mean, there's different traditions. And so Paul is addressing that issue. How do we deal with these different ways, these different understandings? Because some of them are really strong. So he is wanting to right to the strong, and he doesn't identify the strong. I mean, contextually, it would appear that he's talking to Gentiles, but not necessarily, and he's careful not to identify it as that, because sometimes it's more fluid than that. And he's trying to be fairly generic in all of this, or at least not blunt in terms of identifying, because he wants to build bridges, and he's wanting to get to the heart of the matter, which is, as I said last week, a third way. And so he says, but he's addressing the issue of faith and what happens and what we need to be careful of. And he's saying here, all of that which is not from faith is sin. Which is, oh, that's kind of one of those like, oh. But what he is saying here is that any act that does not arise from a conviction that's rooted in one's faith in Christ is sinful. In other words, what Paul is saying is, listen, when I do something, I need to be convinced that it is an act that brings honor or that there is freedom in Christ to do. So last week I spoke of drinking, right? I spoke of the fact that I was raised that drinking is a sin. So for many years, I shouldn't say many years because I didn't, it's not like I was drinking as a five-year-old or had the opportunity to do that, but I just, you know, the very thought when I was around other Christians, let's call it, and I saw them drinking, I was very uncomfortable. And how can they do that? Are they really Christians? And then I realized as I studied and looked at it, I thought, you know what? Drinking isn't a sin. It's just not. Now, it's a lot of other things, and there's wisdom to be applied when it comes to drinking, and there's lots of good reasons to not drink, but it's not a sin. But if I had grown up, if I had then, before I came to that conclusion, had gone ahead and drunk, before I came to that conclusion, Paul is saying that would have been sin. I remember actually my first encounter with a drink, if you want to call it that, was I was working for a photo lab. I was 19, maybe. And we went out for a Christmas party at the photo lab. And I had baked Alaskan. Which baked Alaskan, for those who don't know, is drenched in alcohol, right? And then lit in fire. Kind of cool. But I had it, and I remember driving home thinking, oh boy, am I drunk? I mean, if I haven't had alcohol, and I've had baked Alaskan, there's potential that there's still alcohol in there. I don't know. And I felt kind of weird. And I remember wrestling with the question of faith, right? Did I mess up by not or not? And Paul is just simply saying, listen, if your tradition, if your background is such that you have been told that something is not right to do, if it is sin to do it, then you need to be careful with that, because if you go ahead and violate that, then you are acting in sin in that context. We'll come back to that later. So then he goes on to say, now we who are strong ought to bear the weaknesses of the weak. And now he's shifted his focus to the strong. And he says, listen, we have an obligation to bear the weaknesses of the weak and not please ourselves. Each of us must please our neighbor for the good goal of building up. Why would Paul switch the neighbor? Why does he mention neighbor? Anyone it's the only time it's kind of a weird word to use in this context, because he's not talking about two neighbors here, is he? So why does he use the word neighbor?
Maybe because it means like anyone, like in Jesus' story.
Yes.
Yeah,
I can.
It means like anyone. It ends up meaning like whoever you come across.
Yeah, so anyone you come across. You're right, Lena. But where does that phrase get used in Scripture? Where does the word neighbor get used?